Good evening. Welcome to Civil's Affairs Current Affairs module. We'll straight away go to the important prelims points that occurred in the past few days. Now, a big gaga had gone around in the San Francisco Bay, especially with the blooming of the Cobb's Flower or the Amorphopallis titania. So it's a very rare plant endemic to the Sumatran islands of Indonesia. It's one of the largest blooming flower, as you can see from the image. So this has that structure of a phallus and the petals of great size. Now, it has bloomed not just there in San Francisco Bay, but also in Chicago. But why that gaga? It's not just due to the peculiar flowering nature, not because of the smell alone, but also it blooms only every 7 to 10 years. And the lifespan of these flowers would be around 3 to 4 decades. Now, they basically have this pungent smell, which is like similar to rotten meat. So that is why they have been widely called as a Cobb's Flower. Now, why is this? Because it's to attract certain pollinators. As I've said, they are in the Sumatran forest. You have certain special bees which get attracted to them. So in order to attract them only, this kind of a smell comes up from these flower. They have widely been protected in different parts of the world, but well inside Sumatra, their position is not that good, especially due to felling of trees, due to the loss of forest land for agriculture. So they are at stake. So due to these reasons, IUCN has called this as an endangered plant. Now, the second important news was the Supreme Court ruling on personal guarantees liability on the corporate debt. What happens is you have an institution, okay, and there is a bank. Now, this firm or the institution, they need some money. So there will be people called promoters who would be promoting these firms up. So they would approach the bank and they would say that I am promoting this, or I know this company well, I'm a promoter of this bank, so promoter of this firm, some way or the other. I'm not a part of the board member and so on, but I'm promoter of this firm, so kindly pay them some loan. So, but when this firm becomes a debt-ridden one, this has to be taken aback. Corporate resolution needs to be done. But basically, till before the Supreme Court ruling, these promoters are out of the game. They are not liable for the payback of the loan or for getting the the money back. So with this judgment, what happens is personal liability of these guarantors also comes up, and thereby the banks can also prosecute or try to get money from these promoters also, because ethically speaking, the bank has given money to these firms out of the world or out of the assets that have been held by the promoters. Now, in India, we widely see Buddha in different standing or in sitting position, and rarely we find in the reclining posture. But one such, India's largest, has been unveiled in Bodh Gaya during the Buddha Purnima. Now, this reclining Buddha is of great significance because it is that position of Buddha just before his parinibbana, that is his celestial movement out of the world. Now, this is very significant because he has kept his right hand and in this posture as in a position of moving out from this samsara. It has been widely said that after this parinibbana, he won't have a rebirth back. Now, this the depiction of Buddha is quite interesting because Buddha himself was a person who said, idol worship is not my taste. But in Buddhism, right now we see wider amount of relic worship or image worship of Buddha. Now, reclining Buddha was first depicted in the Gandhara art form and basically raised during the Kushana. In India, very few reclining Buddhas are there. But among Southeastern nations, you have reclining Buddha, especially in the Angkor Wat complex You have similar ones in, I mean, the largest one in the world is actually in Myanmar, like that. Now, reclining Buddha, the imagery has been found in the 26th cave of Ajanta. Now, as I've just said, it has got a significance. So it shows Buddha reclining on his right side, and behind him there are two sala trees. And at the base of the sculpture are the begging bowl, a water pitcher, and a walking stick. So that is how the depiction of the sculpture is in the Ajanta case. It basically promotes about his parinibbana, that how he has happily moved out of the samsara, but how his fellow followers were sad enough. Now, the we have got the other depictions also. That is a Bhumisparsha Mudra, that is the seating Buddha in Mahabodhi temple. That is one posture. In Sarnath, you have the Dharma Chakra Mudra. Also, the most popular depiction in India is a Bodhi tree depiction that you have. Now, a big question or big controversy has erupted basically with the with incidents in West Bengal, and it has emitted to a discussion over the central deputation of IAS officers. Now, the DOPT has recently notified that the number of people who come on deputation is much less. Ignore this part. Now, what is the central deputation? So, we have the IAS, IPS, and the forestry, forest service officers, and the central government would ask out whether there is any willing person from the state to work with in the state. That happens as per the IAS cadre rules. Okay. Now, if there is a agreement between the state and the central, he moves out. You can even transfer that such a person or keeps that person on a deputation on another state also. If there is any kind of disagreement, then the matter shall be decided by the central government, and the state government shall give effect of the decision of the central government. So that is why there is a distinctively controversial portion to this region, and that is why you might have noticed how the chief secretary in West Bengal just turn down and move out. Now, what happens if there is a disagreement? So the rule states that provided that if there is any kind of a disagreement, the matter shall be decided by the central government. Now, considering the same case, we should look at the civil services board. So in order to avoid this frequent transfer of civil servants based on political biasness, now the Supreme Court has directed the center as well as the state to set up a state civil services board that would look up on the transfer and posting of bureaucrats. So it would look after whether the civil servant is not transferred before the completion of their tenure. Now this body, board, will be headed by the chief secretary of the state, the senior most additional chief secretary or chairman, board of revenue, financial commissioner, or any equivalent rank and status would be a member. Now it will have a principal secretary or secretary of department of personnel in the state as the member secretary. Now the government has decided to pay on hand rupees 100 to every students who are from class 1 to 8 as part of the midday meal scheme, that is along with the prime minister's upholding of 5 kg of grains to every family. So this would total up to 1200 crores, addressing 11.8 children. We all know that the World Food Program has highly elevated the idea of midday meal scheme, providing cooked food to kids, especially during the pandemic, and India was hailed out of this great scheme that we have envisaged. Now, as part of the Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan, children in aided as well as government school as well as in madrasas would be supported with one meal. Now, it is actually run by the Ministry of Education. The scheme is covered under the National Food Security Act. As I've said, it is a beautiful scheme where the aim is to reduce hunger and malnutrition, at the same time increase enrollment of students and attendance in school, and also enduring beyond caste kids to school, and also a helping aid for the women. And this is the food norms under the midday meal scheme. Now, in order to target or in order to reduce effects of COVID-19, especially in the first stages, the same method that was adopted to the former US president is now there in India too. That is the monoclonal antibody therapy, especially in New Delhi, but it cost around 50,000 plus. Now, what is this monoclonal antibody therapy, also called as a antibody cocktail? So basically, we will be having lab-made antibodies created, and that would be as injection would be provided to the patient. So why is it called a monoclonal? Because we'll come to it. And why is it called as a cocktail? Down here, we are actually using two monoclonal medicines to target it. Now, monoclonal antibodies are actually antibodies that are created in lab and then provided to the patient. It needs to be, as per ICMR, it needs to be injected in the initial days. We also know that plasma therapy has been removed out of the steps that needs to be taken. Well, coming back to monoclonal antibodies, so they are actually proteins cloned in lab to mimic the antibodies produced. They have their genesis in serum. Now, what happens is, we all know that we will be having a, I'll just show you. We all know that we will be, there is a, we have the antigen here, and this is the antibody, and you know, the spike protein, they just attach and things gets better. So same way, these antigens bind to the proteins, basically bind to the antigen and reduce the disease. Now, how are these monoclonal antibodies created? They are actually created in the lab by exposing white blood cells to particular antigen. So in order to increase the quantity of antibody produced, we clone the white cells in order to create more. So that is why you call it as a monoclonal antibody therapy. And one important thing that which we need to keep in mind is that monoclonal therapy was introduced in India as an emergency process. Unlike other prognostic methods and other medications that we use, monoclonal therapy is a single method that has been developed especially for targeting COVID. Others were repurposed. You know, those therapeutic methods that you see currently might be developed for some other diseases, but some of the features could be utilized in treating COVID. But in case of monoclonal, it is not the case. Monoclonal was a sole alone process for treating COVID. We must know the treatment has two advantages. it needs to be done in the initial stage, and it would avoid hospitalization. So that is the biggest game changer. That is why monoclonal therapy is called as a game changer, because it would reduce hospitalization. We have polyclonal methods also, a cheap method to produce, where mixed population of antibodies would be created, and they may bind to different areas to target molecules. Now, from a deep inside cave in Chhattisgarh, the Jayanti cricket has been found. They are actually called spider cricket because they have a small body and then wider space like cricket. Now, why is this Jayanti so important? Crickets, the male crickets basically hit their leg, you know, and create that vibration that we hear always and make the female get attracted. But the crickets down here, the females, they don't have ears. So they don't rub or they don't hit their legs, but they just make vibrations, especially of their abdomen, and attract the females. So these, the understanding them would be really helpful, especially in treating or in order to create ear, you know, we have certain hearing aids. So creation of hearing aids could become better authenticated by studying how these Jayanti crickets work and communicate. Now, just like Bishnois in Rajasthan and also in the community in Saurashtra, Odisha, especially in the Ganjam district, the people down there, they have protected their black box or the Krishnamriga, and their population has increased or doubled over the 6 months. So blackbuck is a state animal of Punjab, Haryana and Andhra Pradesh. It's actually antelope, widely found in grassy plains and lightly forested area. Now, they are actually of least concern as per as IUCN, but in India, it is placed under Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act. It's a part under sites also. They are widely seen in Gujarat, Bihar, Maharashtra and also in Madhya Pradesh. Now, in order to reduce import and to enhance Atmanirbhar, we have a positive indigenization list, or rather a negative list of imports, especially to the armed forces. The second list has been created now. So this actually looks up for the manufacturing of essentials down in India with plug and play model with private as well as the PSUs together. So it could help develop local defense industry, so provide an ample opportunity for the development of startups and MSME. So positive indigenization list is related to manufacturing of arms. We are obviously, as per CIPRI, in the world, India is the second largest importer of arms. Now, the National Horticulture Board and the Ministry of Agriculture has launched the horticulture cluster development. So there will be 12 horticulture clusters in 12 horticulture clusters out of the total 53 in 11 states. Now, it is like growing certain things depending upon the geography, climatic condition, and making it globally competitive. And this is actually a method for doubling the income for the farmers and also earn up to maximum from exports. And it is also been noted that this cluster-based development would help in dragging in more capital acquisition too. Now we'll move on with the main topic. Now, a very important note has come up, that is, attacking up of women is there, and there is strong linking between caste. So there is actually a caste-based violence that is happening upon women. The big note has come up, especially when a case from Andhra Pradesh reached the Supreme Court. But similar instance in Kathua, multiple cases in Uttar Pradesh, similar cases in Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh, as per the National Crime Records Bureau, suggest that there is caste-based violence against women. No, the academics, lawyers argue that sexual violence take place on account of women's gender and caste, and Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe Prevention of Atrocities Act must be invoked. Let's move on. Now, as I've said, there are so many cases where the prevention of atrocities against SC and ST was not taken up when the case was up, when the victim was from the Dalit, from the SC or ST committee and community, and they were women, and Supreme Court has set apart that. The case with the Ramdas case, the Dinesh Aliya Buddha, the Ashrafi, the Kuman Singh, in all these cases, the prevention of atrocities against SC ST people was kept aside. And what is this act all about? It's actually enacted to protect the marginalized community against discrimination and atrocity. It was introduced in 1989. In 2015, an amendment came up to specifically recognize more atrocities against Dalit and Adivasi women, including sexual assault, Devadasi, dedication, etc. Now, subsection imposes life imprisonment on a non-SCST person who has committed an offense under IPC. However, the offense should have a minimum punishment of 10 years and it should be committed against the victim on the ground that such a person is from the SCST community. Now, the section was amended in 2015 to change the phrase that on the background that such a person is an SCST member too, knowing that such a person is a SCST member. So that specificity has been ingrained to the 2015 thing, and this is very important. Now, there is something called as intersectionality. Now, intersectionality is an analytical framework for understanding how aspect of person's social and political identity combine to create different modes of discrimination. Now, here, look at the case. You have gender as well as caste being taken up. So that is what it says. Intersectionality defines multiple factors of advantage and disadvantage, like gender, caste, sex, race, class, sexuality, religion, disability, and physical appearance. These intersecting and overlapping social identity may be both empowering as well as oppressing. In this case, this intersectionality has become an oppressive thing. Now, an intersectional approach to feminism acknowledges that while women share similar experience of discrimination, harassment, sexism, inequality, and oppression on the basis of their sex and gender, not all women are equally disadvantaged or have equal access to resources. So thus, intersectionality approach seeks to recognize the multiple grounds of marginalization faced by women. So why was this concision, why is that in earlier incidents where the prevention of atrocity was not taken, you have the 1989 rule amended in 2015 considering two things, that the atrocities against women is being taken into consideration, and also the fact that you know them, you know that they are belonging to that community, and then you have perpetuated atrocity against them becomes a culpable offense. But still, Supreme Court hasn't taken the cases depending on that. So why is it desirable that Prevention of Atrocities Act needs to be taken up? First, repeated setting aside of conviction under the Act and strengthens the allegation that the law is misused by the marginalized section. High acquittal rates motivates the dominant community for continuing the same. And the, as you have said, the amended rule has become it more stringent. So, placing a person or punishing a person depending on the rule will be much stronger. Now, what is the way forward? Obviously, as said by the parliamentary committee, that the high acquittal rate motivates and boosts the confidence of dominant and powerful communities to continue the perpetration. Now, the judgment was a missed opportunity for the court to use intersectionality to uphold the conviction. Now, we have to stop hiding behind the smoke screens of high technicality and recognize caste-based violence against women. Interpretation of PEO Act that it reflects the lived experience of women facing sexual violences. Concluding, let me just say that as the father of our Indian Constitution, Ambedkar, has said during his last speech in Constitution, you have a good constitution and you have a bad set of people doing it, things goes wrong. You have a bad constitution and you have good people working it out, things would be better. You have a strong rule, but people are misusing it. You have set of wrong rules and been implemented by the virtuous people. That is a case that is affecting India right now. Now, the last topic for the day is obviously the last week's most hot topic, how Facebook and other institution had a lock horn with the Indian government. Finally, they all retreated. They started accepting the IT acts of IT rule of 2021, but Twitter stayed away. But finally, after certain threats, Twitter has been a part of the IT rules 2021. What is this IT rule all about? Now, the IT rule of 2021, called the Guidelines for Intermediaries and Digital Media Ethics Code, basically sets certain important things. First thing is they have categorized the intermediaries, basically social media, as we say, to two: intermediaries and bigger intermediaries. So the big tech companies would come under the big intermediaries and others would be just intermediaries. Why such a classification? These big intermediaries will have certain other clauses that they need to take up. Now, the second thing is that they have to appoint certain special officers under them. Third thing is the special regulation that they have placed for the over-the-top platform or the OTT platforms with respect to content. Also, the government is they are having the right to remove the content that stays against the interest, which has been widely been said or mentioned. Another thing is that it is the duty or it is a responsibility of these aggregators or these intermediaries with respect to the content that the workers are basically the people who are using it is. So it is their duty of the intermediaries to look upon, and the government has the right to move it, to remove it. And the most controversial is that their social media platforms must give the data to the government as to who has written it and how the loop of sending or movement of fake message and such information happened. So that actually goes against the end-to-end encryption that the media platform like WhatsApp provides. It is equivalent to snooping of the people, moving against privacy. So that is a big concern. But let us look in. So now all major social media intermediaries have not adhered to the requirement, and we have certain cases behind that too. Now, the rule basically says that social media companies are prohibited from hosting or publishing any unlawful information. Now, if such information is hosted or published, the government can take down such information within 24 mechanism. The provision requires social media platform to compulsorily identify the first originator of the information, most contentious one, and it calls for the social media companies to publish monthly compliance report. Now, this has moved in to a case in Supreme Court, and WhatsApp has registered one. So it basically says that these ideas, especially moving behind the perpetrator, is actually breaking the end-to-end encryption and laxity of privacy. But government says that privacy is not an absolute right. Traceability obligation is only a reasonable restriction, and government argues that traceability provision is in line with the Puthuswamy judgment. Now, why is this rule widely hailed? Because non-consensual intimate pictures would be removed in 24 hours, a complaints report to increase transparency, setting up of dispute resolution mechanism for content removal, adding a label to information to users to know whether content is advertised, owned, sponsored or exclusively controlled. Now, what are the associated issues? As I've just said, it could be taken down. Any content which the government says is not up to could be taken down, so it undermines free speech. The government has put forward the traceability, breaching of privacy, saying privacy is not a fundamental right, so the traceability issue. And the fair resources, because the intermediary is now supposed to take down the content when an order from the government comes. So it basically deprives fair resources. Now, we don't have a data privacy law, and you are coming up with these things which are moving into the privacy of the person working out. So this rule will be counterproductive. These rules would be counterproductive provided India is not having a data privacy law. There is terrible compliance burden and the lack of scrutiny because it has come up with the haste. We didn't have any kind of a consultation with the stakeholders or never been discussed in parliament or so. So it is having lack of scrutiny and brought up with haste. Now, the fair recourse privacy issues, and intermediary is now supposed to take down content within 36 hours. It places fetters upon the speech by fixing government as the ultimate adjudicator of objectionable speech online. The rule undermines the right to privacy. It breaks the immunity, thereby weakening the security of privacy of these conversations. Now, vulnerability to attack from ill-intended third parties. The threat has only in privacy. Now it extends to invasion and deprivation of free space. Now, there are certain suggestions that have come up, like the Ofcom has a community regulator in UK. Similarly, we can have such community regulators to strengthen citizens' rights. Now, the five industrial bodies have sought an extension of 6 to 12 months for the compliance because the government can provide time relaxation for companies. In the meantime, government can bring both private and industry experts to address a genuine concern. And it is said that India did not have the GDPR like in UAE, in similar to EU. So you don't have such a data protection rule, and bringing such things, you know what happens? This becomes a counter-protective act. So uniform application of law, deliberating and discussing with stakeholders and creating the rule in a better way, statutory backing, especially with the privacy rule, expediting data protection law, expediting the passing of personal data protection bill, all needs to be done. It's a good rule, it has got good sense, but the essential background work has not been done. It needs to be done. If that is also done, things would be rosy and good. So these are the important content as far as the current affairs session is concerned. We'll come up with more vibrant, interesting topics next week. Until then, goodbye.